Well, good afternoon. It's good to be back in the Lord's house this Sunday afternoon. We'll stand together, turn to 235, and sing He Set Me Free. Choir, make your way on up while we sing. Once like a bird in prison I dwelt, no freedom from sorrow I felt. But Jesus came and listened to me. Glory to God, He set me free. He set me free, yes, He set me free. He broke the bonds of prison for me. I'm glory bound, my Jesus to see. For glory to God, He set me free. Now I am climbing higher each day. Darkness of night has drifted away. My feet are planted on higher ground. Glory to God, I'm homeward bound. He set me free, yes, He set me free. And He broke the bonds of prison for me. I'm glory bound by Jesus to see. For glory to God, He set me free.
Goodbye on the third. Here we go. Goodbye.
Goodbye to sin.
Amen. Good be in the Lord's house tonight. Amen. Amen. Let's remain standing for a word of prayer. Then we'll get into service tonight. As we pray tonight, let's remember all of our preachers out of the church. I'll not take time to call all of them's names, but let's do remember them. Brother Williams is preaching out again tonight. And then Brother Josh starts revival over at Bethany Baptist Church in Hayes tonight through Friday night. So do remember him and pray that the Lord would help him and meet the needs there. Amen. Then do continue to pray for Miss Melba's family. Pray that the Lord will continue to help there and meet the needs there. Of course, we went by and seen her family today, and she seemed to be holding up really good, but do remember them and pray for them. Pray that the Lord will continue to help there. You that went by, thank you so much for doing that. I know she appreciates it, and I appreciate it as your pastor for doing that, and I really do, and thank you for going by. But do remember them. Pray for them. Then the different ones that are sick, do remember them. Remember Brother Tim's mom. Do keep praying for her. She's at the hospice house. Pray that the Lord will continue to help there. Do remember little Kinsley. Pray that the Lord will continue to help there and meet the needs there with Kinsley, and pray that the Lord would help her there. Amen. And God knows those needs, and let's remember Amen. That and pray for her. Amen. Then remember Eamon. You may not have noticed it this morning, but he broke his collarbone, and yesterday he wrecked a four-wheel and broke his collarbone, possibly facing surgery in the next few days. So do remember that and pray for them. Pray that the Lord would help him and meet the needs there. Amen. Brother Dakota, how did it go where you was at this morning? Good morning. You was at Hillside?
West Side.
In Hillsville. Okay. Had a good morning there. Amen. So thank the Lord for that. And let's pray the Lord helps us tonight. Let's remember revival. Amen. Amen. A week from today we'll start revival. Let's pray that the Lord would help there and meet the needs in it. Amen. Brother Andrew Cass Stevens, how about you open us up in prayer?
Hear me.
You can be seated. Worship with the choir tonight, as they say.
Hear me.
She's like,
yeah.
Let's stand around, shake hands as the choir comes down. Amen. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. Amen. Wonderful, wonderful song. Let me make a couple quick announcements, then we'll get right into the service tonight. Don't forget service on Wednesday night. Amen. Looking forward to a good time Wednesday night. Excited to see what the Lord's got for us. Amen. So make sure you're here on Wednesday night. And Kids for Christ or Discovery Club will start at 7 o'clock, and then service will start at 7 o'clock also. And going to be a good night in the Lord's house, so remember that. And then don't forget this coming up Saturday. This coming up Saturday will be the chicken stew. Amen. I'm excited about that. It'll be ready at 5 o'clock. And we'll meet down at the river, down at the picnic shelter. And looking forward to that. We always have a good time with that. And I guess, man, it's 5, 6, 7 years straight we've been doing that. And looking forward to it. So remember that. Make sure you favor that on Saturday. And then next Sunday, revival starts next Sunday with Brother Jamie Healy. And I'm looking forward to hearing him preach. I promise you, you're going to enjoy it, Brother Jamie Healy. He is a blessing. He's a younger preacher, not a real young preacher, but a younger preacher. He's probably a little bit younger than I am. And he'll be with us on Sunday morning and Sunday night. They'll be in enough time Saturday afternoon, as long as everything goes good. You'll be able to meet him and his wife down at the chicken stew, and then he'll be preaching for us on Sunday. And then Monday through Wednesday night, Brother Milton Taylor, my soul, what a preaching machine he is. And Brother Taylor's a little bit different, you'll understand it once you get to listening to him, but I promise you, you're going to love Brother Milton Taylor. And Brother Milton's probably in his mid-70s now, and he's actually had, it was 6 or 9, I can't remember what he told me, like it may have been 7, but nervous breakdowns down through the years, and man, he is just a champion. Now, let me just go ahead and tell this to you. If you say something to him and he don't acknowledge you, it's not that he's being rude. He's just about deaf. Matter of fact, Friday the phone rung and it said Brother Taylor was on our way to meet, and Brother Granville was driving me, and I said, don't get scared. I'm going to have to holler on the phone. And I went, hello! And that's really the way you have to talk on the phone. And his wife said, well, hey, preacher, how are you doing? I said, I'm sorry. But you talk to his wife 99% of the phone. You don't even talk to him on the phone because he can't hear good. But I promise you, when he opens that Bible, and it's funny, sometimes he'll forget to switch his hearing aids, and he'll switch them in the pulpit. He'll say, now just stay with me just a minute. I got to get my preaching hearing aids in. And he'll get them switched out. And then, son, when he get, I think that, I'm going to try that one that he puts in his ear when he preaches and see if it'll help me any. Yeah, I think it gets to getting voices from the other end or something other. But I'm telling you, you're going to love Brother Milton Taylor. Monday through Wednesday, and then Thursday and Friday, Brother Jimmy Millsap. Man, what a blessing Brother Jimmy Millsap is. And one of my heroes. He's been a tremendous help to me down through the years. And he saved me a lot of heartaches down through the years and different things. And man, I sure love Brother Jimmy Millsap. He'll be with us on Thursday night and Friday night. It's going to be a great, great week next week. So remember that, and make sure you're faithful. Amen. We'll have a good time in God's house and excited to see what the Lord's going to do for us in revival. Amen. Make sure you're faithful on Wednesday night. Again, Discovery Program for ages 3 to 11 out in the fellowship hall. I'll just go ahead and hit this real quick while we're on that. During revival, we'll not have that on the Wednesday night of revival. Everybody will be in here during the revival week, but we'll pick it right back up that next week. Amen. And I don't want the adults to miss out. I don't want the young people to miss out on Brother Taylor. Amen. I don't know what he's going to preach. I've not put any request in, but I hope one of the nights he'll deal some out of the book of Romans on the abundance of the Christian life and the victorious Christian life. It is unreal to hear him preach that. It's life changing to hear him preach it. Amen. And I'm not asking him to preach it. I just want him to preach what God wants. Amen. If I was to ask him, I know he'd preach it, but I'm not going to ask him. The Lord may not want it. Amen. So I want what the Lord wants. Amen. So remember that and make sure you're faithful to a revival. Try to bring somebody with you next Sunday, and somebody's not here today, send them a message and let them know. Amen. I try to throughout the week, but it's good for them to hear from others also. So remember that and work towards that. Amen. End of the year is not far away. Let me just say this real quick. December the 26th through December the 30th, or the 29th. December 26th, 27th, 28th, 29th will be the Winter Jubilee there at Brother David Edwards again. The youth meeting that we all went to last year. Go ahead and start thinking about that. We'll get our rooms Thursday and Friday night like we did last year. And I do have the option to get the rooms the whole place that we had last year, but I need to know that we can fill that up before I do that. And I think there was 12 rooms on that is what there is. So if you're interested in going, let me know. Matter of fact, here's what we'll do. I'll not do it tonight, but I'll try to get it. Yeah, we can. Brother Heath, grab a piece of paper out of the copy machine back there and just put winter meeting on it. And put it on that table right there. And start signing up. I'll give you a week or two to sign up on that and sign up for that. I can't remember exactly what the cost was on the rooms last year. Does anybody else remember what they was? $80 a night. I thought that was right. It's $80 a night, so $160 for both nights. And that's a continental breakfast included in it. And of course, we feed lunch there at the meeting, so you'll have a good lunch at the meeting. And hey, you know what you need to do? You just need to plan on going. You say, well, what if we need more than 12 rooms? We've already got 25 reserved at another place, and we got some more holding at another place. So we'll have room, amen. But anyway, go ahead and get signed up on that. Hey, if you went last year, don't miss it this year. And if you didn't go last year, don't miss it this year, amen. It's an awesome meeting. And on Wednesday night, or on Thursday night, Thursday night and Friday night will be the same lineup as it was last year. Thursday night will be Brother Jeremy and Brother Brian preaching. On Friday night will be me and Dad preaching. And then on Friday morning, preachers will be called off the floor, and Brother Todd McKeon will close that morning service. Saturday morning, preachers will be called off the floor, and Brother Trent McKeon will close that morning service. So it'll be a good, good meeting. So remember that. Then I'll just throw this out in passing while I'm announcing meetings. The Oasis Conference that Brother Heath Williams does will be the last day of February, and it's February 27th, isn't it, through March the 1st. Anyway, it's right in there. It ends on March the 1st, don't it, Miss Morgan? March the 2nd, because it's her birthday. Ends on March the 2nd. So it's March the 28th through March the 2nd. Now, that won't work, will it? Son, if that's what it is, that's going to be a long meeting. February 28th through March the 2nd. There in Greensboro, that's Thursday, Friday, and Saturday there in Greensboro. And if you want to get in a good meeting, if you got some days, that's a new year right there. If you got some days you want to take off work and get in a real good meeting, I'm trying to think. Brother CT's preaching in it. Brother Daniel Buchanan's preaching in it. Brother Leonard Fletcher's preaching in it. Brother Tyler Gordon will be there. Brother Heath will be there. I'll be doing a special session this year on the importance of youth ministry in the local church. And it's a great meeting, so just keep that in the back of your mind and try to be a part of that if you want to. Amen. But remember that, and then sign up if you want to go to the youth meeting. If you're a young person and you want to go to the youth meeting and your parents are not going, let me see how many adults we get signed up, and if we've got enough adults that can take you underneath their wing, we'll try to work something out on that so you can go also. All right? So remember that. Amen. I tell you what, ladies, it's going to help us with a mission letters tonight. I don't even know who you are, but whoever you are, come on up to the platform tonight. We'll recognize our mission letters. We're going to start doing this, and I hope you're going by the missions display. I got worried there for a minute because Adam got up. If you're going by the missions display, and I thought he might be getting a phone call from Russia and had to go out and answer it. Hope you're going by the missions display. Isn't that right, Brother Adam? Did he say he was going to hurt me? Bailey, stand up. Just stand up. Dad, your dad just said this morning he's on my side. You might go get Uncle Freddie and we might talk here. But anyway, hey, can I tell you something? How many had some trials this week? Let's just be honest. I mean, he's had some burdens this week. You know what just happened in the last 45 seconds? You forgot about every bit of it. That's the reason the Bible says a merry heart doeth good like a medicine. It does. I'm just glad we got to take it all out on Adam tonight. Amen? But a merry heart will help you. Hope you're going by the missions display and looking at the letters on the missions display. And send our missionaries an email. You can do that straight off the missions display and go by and visit it. But we're going to let these ladies tell us about the different missionaries we've heard from this week. And I'll say this real quick, and then they're going to start. Brother Fred Hawks will not be receiving any more letters from him. Brother Fred has resigned. I got the letter this week from Rock of Ages Prison Ministries. And the letter really didn't give no great explanation, but he has resigned from them. So I appreciate him, though, for many years. He was faithful with them for probably 25, 30 years. He's been with Rock of Ages. He's been with them a long time, and I appreciate his faithfulness. See, ma'am, these ladies is going to tell us who we heard from. You going to start us out, Miss Gay? There you go. Step on up there. Ladies, y'all can sit down back there if you want to. I'm not going to stand during all this. I told them they had to keep it within an hour. And Miss Holly said, does that mean I can preach 45 minutes? Where's my bell at? I might need to get...
This letter comes from Brother Stennett Ballew. He says, I'm writing this prayer letter as we are cruising at 567 miles per hour, 31,000 feet high, on my way home from a missions meeting in Santa Fe, New Mexico. Lord gave us a great meeting with Pastor Chris Rogers, I think it's Charles's cousin, and the dear folks there at the Harvest Baptist Church. Brother Chris has been in New Mexico for 6 years and has been used of the Lord to begin the Open Door Baptist Church meeting for 5 years in a storefront building. The Lord opened the door for Open Door Baptist Church to merge with Temple Baptist Church. Temple had a large church building and their pastor wanted to retire, so they merged and named the new church Harvest Baptist Church. This week they had their first missions meeting since the merger. The two churches gave a combined total of $21,000 last year to missions. But on yesterday, their new faith promise commitment was about $33,000, with some of the given people not present. These amounts to about a 60% increase over last year. The people were blessed and amazed as the Holy Spirit began to open their understanding of the teaching of the scriptures on mission. Then on over here, he says he was saved August the 16th. He's been saved for 67 years. He's completed 58 years of preaching. He preached his first message on September 25th, 1960. He has, October 3rd, he finished 36 years full-time in missions and evangelism. And the first of November 1st, finished 25 years of daily broadcasting. He says, all I can say is, the Lord is good.
Amen. This missions letter is from Wes and Rachel Gazaway. Says Rachel and I continue to be amazed at how God has been working through our furlough. This last month, we saw another young man accept Christ as a Savior in one of our meetings. Also, I was able to spend about 2 hours talking to a 60-year-old man named Pete. Pete claims to be a SBNR, which means spiritual but not religious. However, he just watched his, this breaks my heart, he just watched his 89 and 91-year-old parents die without Christ. His own testimony told how they withered away, how they were hollow, alone, frail, and scared. And he said, while I'm not sure that Christ is real and that he's the only way to God, even if there is a heaven, I'm willing to read the Gospel of John and think about it.
I don't want to die like my parents did. Please pray for Pete to be saved in the days to come. Grace Baptist Church continues to reach out to the surrounding community as we strive to be a light in the midst of our neighbors. Last month, we were able to assist nearly 500 families for their children. We praise God for every opportunity that we receive to have a small part in the lives of so many precious families and their building project that they have. He says last month they received $55,156 in funds. Please help us to pray for the remainder to be given in God's timing.
Amen. Amen. Brother West is one of our newest missionaries in Egypt. He's one that we just took on in Egypt.
This is from the Hernandez family in Guatemala. And so they start off, he says, this month has brought many trials and blessings to our lives and ministry, but through every step, the Lord has brought peace, comfort, and strength to get through and keep pressing on. John 14:27, peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. And he says that he started his month in Mexico, and they were working down to Guatemala, and they got to have a new to us vehicle. But he got sick, and he had salmonella poisoning, and he was in the hospital for 3 days. And his concern was his wife and his baby, and his mother-in-law was coming to fly to Guatemala. And he had a six-hour drive home, and he had to go through the customs at the border. But he says, I praise the Lord that he gave me strength, and I was able to make it to the airport to pick up my family. He said, it's been a trying time, but praise the Lord, we are all feeling better now, because all of them were sick eventually. And then he talks about how both churches are doing great and continuing to flourish and grow. He said, we actually had some first-time visitors at both churches last week, and for that we are grateful. He says, we will be starting a midweek service in both villages starting next month. And Marisa and I will be teaching a Bible study on Friday nights at both churches to the men and women. We look forward to teaching our members more in depth of the Word and on home. And he has some prayer. He was talking about some issues that they're having with their equipment. He said, we also ask that you pray as some of our appliances have gone bad after being away for a little over a year. He said our dryer is particularly having major issues on its last leg. He said it stays too cold and wet here to hang multiple loads at a time, and especially now with a baby. He says also pray for our laptop, and that's their only tool that they have in the ministry. And he says it's been crashing and having issues. And he says we know none of this has come as a surprise to our God, and that he will continue to supply our every need. And he just says that God continue to bless everybody.
This is from the Knowles family of East Africa. He says that they have been busy traveling and updating many of our supporting churches, and also had the privilege to present our ministry in a few new churches as well. It has been a blessing to share what the Lord has done and the vision going forward. We have enjoyed getting to see many family and friends, but our hearts are there in Uganda. It is our prayer that the Lord will provide the needed funds for us to make a short trip back in October to begin the process of a land purchase, as well as carrying several bags of clothes back for the children. They have also been counseling with two couples, and they plan for their wedding when they return. They are also making plans for their first youth camp in mid-January. Please continue to pray for our family and the work in Uganda. Pastor Boniface at Blessed Hope Baptist Church, and Brother James and Brother Eli, who are preaching and filling the pulpit at Welcome Baptist Church. Also pray that the Lord would supply the need for the land purchase for the church building and the dorms for the Bible Institute and youth camp. They said thank you all, and that we are also in their prayers.
This is from the Manley family with World Harvest Albania Baptist Missions. Since our last letter, the Lord has helped us find a home and a vehicle. We are extremely excited about our new home. We have finally gotten mostly settled in. In our previous letter, we shared that we are renting two floors of a four-story villa, one floor for our living quarters and the other for a schoolroom for our girls and an office. Our girls just recently got to break in their new schoolroom, and they love it. We have always done our homeschooling in the living room or hotel rooms while we were on deputation. I hope that's right. They spring up every morning and are excited to have the opportunity to leave home and walk downstairs to go to school. Even though it's still a short distance to go, it means the world to them and Sister Chelsea to be able to get out of the house and go to school. We're also very thankful to those who gave towards our school materials, furniture, and books. We were able to purchase all that we needed and more for our girls to have a more comfortable, fun, and exciting school year. Also, in the past 2 months, Sister Chelsea and I celebrated our 10-year wedding anniversary along with Madeline's 8th birthday. We are so very thankful for the Lord giving us 10 amazing years and blessing us with our 3 beautiful girls. The Lord has also opened a great door of ministry in which we have partnered with Brother Daxel Wells. It's a hospital outreach ministry in which we carry supplies once or twice a week to those here in the hospital to use during their stay. Unfortunately, both the Wells family and ours have had experiences in the hospital here. Our youngest, Margaret, fell and hit her head just above her eye and had to have stitches. The Wells family, however, has been in the hospital more extensively. During their stay, we were able to help them with supplies that we found were not available in the hospitals here. Simple items such as toilet paper, bottled water, paper towels, toothpaste, and brushes, soap, shampoo, etc., are not supplied during someone's stay in the hospital. Families have to gather these items and more from their home themselves. Therefore, the Lord provided an avenue of ministry in which we gather many of these simple supplies in bags accompanied with a John Romans Bible, a tract, and an invitation to church, and we deliver them personally to each room with a nurse assisting us. Once we learn more of the language, we will be able to communicate with the people more about their needs and share the gospel with them more effectively. But until then, we do have an interpreter to go with us. Each of these bags costs us between $1.50 to $2.50 to make, depending on the availability of supplies and their cost. We are also excited to soon be able to visit the children's division in the hospital and provide these bags to them, accompanied with a small toy. We believe this to be a great avenue of ministry, as the church in Sarande is so very close to the hospital, just a couple of buildings down. The 2 weeks that the Lord has allowed us to go, we have been very well received. If any of you have any interest or burden to help us financially with this ministry, please contact us by any of the means in the side portion of this letter. Please be in prayer for the families we meet in this ministry, along with the nurses that help us. The Albanian language has lived up to its reputation, put in the category as one of the top 5 hardest languages to learn. We are currently enrolled in classes twice a week and also study with the other missionaries periodically throughout the week. We have already finished our first beginner's book, and with what little we know, we are able to carry broken conversations with the people depending on the vocabulary we have obtained for the situation. In my biblical studies recently, I read Psalms 119:27, "Make me to understand the way of thy precepts, so shall I talk of thy wondrous works." We have come not only to desire this of the Word of God, but also the Albanian language to understand so that we can effectively share the gospel of Christ. We had a conversation with a missionary in Albania a few years ago that told us this: one of the most discouraging but equally encouraging things you will ever have to face is spending your first 4 to 5 years sitting at your desk trying your hardest to learn this language, watching men and women and families walk past the window of your home without hope, joy, and Christ on their way to hell, and you can't communicate with them. It is necessary. We have realized over the past few months of being here that these words were very wise. It is one of the most discouraging, difficult things we have faced to not be able to tell someone about the Lord in their native tongue, but equally one of the most encouraging things is we're getting there. We are learning, and in the near future, without any help from an interpreter, we will be able to share the news with them, how Jesus died, why he died, and how he's not willing that any should perish. Please help us pray the Lord would help us.
Dr. Ron Beatty of Return America says that God has greatly used this organization to uphold that which is right and stand against that which threatens our Bible and American freedoms. They are grateful to have prevailed in court over the city of Lincoln, North Carolina, when they tried to prevent a preacher from preaching in the streets. In a few days, the city of Lincoln will be presented with a civil summons to appear in federal court to explain to the court why they tried to infringe upon these rights. He goes on to say, they believe it's vitally important that we prevail on this issue in order to send a signal that the First Amendment rights still prevail in America.
Amen. tell you what, Brother Beatty's doing an awesome job. And he sure is. And thank God for our missionaries. Amen. You said, Preacher, why did you recognize all of them tonight? Because we ought to know where our money's going. Amen. When you give into missions. And I tell you what, I like it, what Brother Manley was doing there. And that hospital ministry, that is a great way to help those in time of need. Amen. And I thought about this. He mentioned that. And then also, Brother Gasway mentioned their building program, and in that they're working on a building for the Bible College and then a new church plant. That's all going towards that. And we give to missions to give it away. We got over $11,000 in the missions account, and we give to missions to give it out. Amen. We don't give to missions to build it up. Give to missions to get it out. We're just a storehouse when it comes to missions. You give to missions through the local church. The local church gives it out to the missionary. And why don't we give Brother Manley and Brother Gasway both $500 apiece to help with those needs right there, the hospital ministry, and then to go towards their building program. And can I get a motion and a second? We'll do that. I have a motion by Brother Heath, second by Brother Randy. All in favor, let it be known by saying amen. And I'm sure that that'll be a blessing to them. Amen. And I tell you what, that with Brother Beatty, I learned this a long time ago. You call Brother Beatty in, you're going to have a fight. Yeah, man, he's going to stand for what's right, and that's awesome right there, what he done. Amen, or what the Lord done through that. Amen. Ushers, come on tonight. Let's get our Sunday night missions offering, and you make sure you give good to world missions. We are going to be having a missions meeting first of the year, trying to get all of that scheduled, and been talking to Dad, and Dad's going to come in. I think I've got him talked into leaving on a Sunday morning through a Wednesday night, coming doing a missions conference for us, and that'll be good. I'm excited about that. Amen. Miss Morgan, come get ready to sing for us in the offering tonight. Isn't that right? Is that right? You're supposed to sing tonight, aren't you? You think so? Well, I thought so too. Okay, good deal. I thought, man, I've messed up and called the wrong one to sing. At least you's willing to sing. Amen. And you worship with her as she sings tonight. You give good to world missions tonight. Amen. Brother Robert, how about you ask some blessing over the offering? Amen. Y'all worship with her.
I believe there are streets of gold, but it's all right with me. If there's nothing more than a worn old gravel road, and I know a mansion's waiting, but a cabin suits me fine. Just a place where I can rest my heavy load. Oh, they say there is a river that flows beneath the throne, and a surface there reflects that holy place. Oh, I'm sure that all the splendor will be so grand to see, but what I long to see the most is Jesus' face. 'Cause that's all that matters to me. To bow my head and thank my blessed Savior on my knees, on those peaceful hills of glory, in His presence I will be. To know I'm home, that's all that matters to me. Oh, the lights of that fair city will never fade away. It's a perfect land where night will never come. But all the beauty I'll behold there can't compare to how I'll feel when I hear my precious Lord say, well done. 'Cause that's all that matters to me. To bow my head and thank my blessed Savior on my knees. On those peaceful hills of glory in His presence I will be. To know I'm home, that's all that matters to me.
Amen. Amen. That is all that matters. Amen. I'm looking forward to that day. Let's take Bibles and go to the book of Psalms tonight. Thank you, Miss Morgan, for that good song. And we'll see what we can learn out of here. The book of Psalms, the 85th division tonight. Psalms 85. And we'll look out of here. And I don't mention this all the time, but I will say it tonight. We're in the middle of the first semester of Bible college. And if you want to come sit in on any of the classes, you can. It won't cost you anything. And you can come sit in. They say it's been going good. And I think I've taught either two or three nights. Two nights. Brother Dakota's keeping record of it over here. I've taught two nights this whole semester, and Brother Matt's taught a lot this semester, but I'll be there this Tuesday night, then I'll be gone another Tuesday night. It'll be our revival, but then I'll be back for several Tuesday nights. But anyway, they're studying the life of Gideon. That's what I'm teaching, and Brother Matt's been teaching more than me, but anyway, studying the life of Gideon, and then also studying eschatology, the things to come, the study of things to come, or the different judgments in the Bible. And I know it's been great, and I know that you'll enjoy it if you want to come sit in one night. Amen. Psalms, the 85th division tonight. Let's stand in honor and reverence to the reading of God's Word. Psalms 85, I'll read a few verses to you, and then you can be seated. Familiar verses tonight. Matter of fact, the points of the message I've used before. I'll give you some stuff in the introduction that I've not used before, but three simple points at the end I have said before, but it'll be all right to look at them again tonight. The Bible said this in verse number 1, Lord, Thou hast been favorable unto Thy land. Thou hast brought back the captivity of Jacob. Thou hast forgiven the iniquity of Thy people. Thou hast covered all their sins, Selah. Thou hast taken away all Thy wrath. Thou hast turned Thyself from the fierceness of Thine anger. Turn us, O God, of our salvation, and cause Thine anger towards us to cease. Wilt Thou be angry with us forever? Wilt Thou draw out Thine anger to all generations? Wilt Thou not revive us again, that Thy people may rejoice in Thee? Show us Thy mercy, O Lord, and grant us Thy salvation. Now, Lord, I pray over the next few minutes tonight, God, that You'd help us and use us, Lord. God, give us exactly what we need in this service tonight. I pray, God, that every word that comes out of our mouth, God, would be the words ordained by God tonight and led by the Holy Spirit. God, I pray, Lord, that You would revive us again. God, we'll be careful to give You the thanks, the glory, and the honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. You can be seated. Had all intentions of going to the book of Jeremiah tonight and preaching out of the book of Jeremiah. And actually, when I was praying the closing prayer today, God brought me back to Psalms 85 in my mind. And then this evening, as I come back in from the funeral home, I began to look at it and meditate on this again. And I love Psalms 85. It's a great, great Psalms. And there's a lot that can be said about it. Whenever you begin to look at Psalms 85, there's six times in the first three verses verses that you'll find the words thou hast. He says, thou hast been favorable unto thy land. Who is the thou hast? Of course, the beginning of verse number 1 tells us who it is. Lord, thou hast. He's not giving the credit to nobody else. He's giving every bit of the credit to God tonight. He says, Lord, thou hast been favorable unto thy land. Thou hast brought back the captivity of Jacob. You see the restoration of God's people there. In verse number 2, he continues with the thou hast. He says, thou hast forgiven the iniquity of thy people. Thou hast covered, I like this word, all their sin, Selah. You see in verse number 2, the remission of sin. The restoration of God's people come from the Lord. The remission of sin come from the Lord also. We cannot find remission of for sin within ourselves. We can't forgive ourselves. It takes God to do that. Matter of fact, one of the greatest struggles with a lot of Christians is learning how to forgive themselves for what God has already forgiven them for. Amen. You sit down and talk to people and begin to speak with them about different things, and you'll find that. But God finds, the children of Israel finds that remission of their sins. He says, thou hast been thou hast forgiven the iniquity of thy people. That word forgiven is a burden, has been lifted and carried away. And the children of Israel says, or David says, when I think about my iniquity and I think about my sin and I think about what I've done, he said, God has lifted that burden and carried it away. Can I remind you that David did fall short of the Lord on many occasions, and we read of that. Matter of fact, the sword never departed from David's house because of David's great sin. But David says, the Lord has forgiven that sin. He has washed that away. There's that remission of sin. Verse number 3, he begins out again. Thou hast taken away all thy wrath. Thou hast turned thyself from the fierceness of thine anger. There's the removal of God's wrath. David says, thou hast done this. So these first 3 verses, David is doing nothing but bragging on God and uplifting God and praising God for what God has done. Can I say this in passing tonight? I really believe we're way behind on that right there. And we're here tonight because thou hast. Amen. We're breathing tonight because thou hast. We've got nice homes tonight because thou hast. We're not going to hell tonight because thou hast. We're able to serve God because thou hast. And David says 6 times in 3 short verses, God, I'll just magnify you for what you've done. He goes into verse number 4 and you find repentance. He says, turn us, O God, of our salvation, and cause thine anger towards us to cease. He said, turn us, O God. It would have been in vain for them to pray for the removal of divine judgment and divine wrath if they wasn't willing to turn themselves. Yeah. Do you hear what I just said? It would have been in vain for them to pray for God to turn His judgment if they wasn't willing to turn from their sin. Now here's what we do a lot of times. We say, God, will you help us, but we won't turn from our sin. Amen, right there, preacher. We say, God, I need you right now, but we're not willing to turn from our wickedness. It would have been in vain for them to pray for the removal of divine wrath if they wasn't willing to turn from their sins. One writer said this, it is not that God needs turning from His anger so much as that we need turning from our sin. Amen. Let me say that again. It is not that God needs turning from His anger so much as that we need turning from our sin. Amen. We need turning from our sin. We need turning from our sin. He goes on as he's in verse number 5. He says, wilt thou be angry with us forever? Wilt thou draw out thine anger to all generations? Wilt thou not revive us again that thy people may rejoice in thee? I find in verse number 5 and 6 a threefold question. He says this, wilt thou be angry with us forever? David says, Lord, will your anger towards us be forever? He said, wilt thou draw out thine anger to all generations? I began to look at that and I thought about this. Let me read you a verse right here out of Psalms 103. Here's what he said in Psalms 103. He said, wilt thou be angry with us forever? Psalms 103 says, he will not always chide, neither will he keep his anger forever. You know what? Any question within the Bible, there is an answer for that. The psalmist said, Lord, are you going to be angry with us forever? And the Bible answered that and said that God will not always chide with man, and his anger will not always be towards man. If the anger of God was all that we ever experienced, we'd be going to hell tonight. I don't know about anybody else. I'm thankful that the anger of God will not last forever. He goes on to say this, wilt thou not draw out, or wilt thou draw out thine anger to all generations? David is saying this, will the anger of God be drawn out to every generation? Look what he said in Psalms 103:17. But the mercies of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. And he goes on to say, upon them that fear him and his righteousness unto children's children. You know what he's saying? Here's what he's saying. No. He's saying, I'm not going to cause that to go to all generations. Then he comes into verse number 6 where I want to be. And he asks this final question. He says, wilt thou not revive us again? Lord, would you not revive us again? Lord, would you not do something great for us again? God, would you not stir our hearts again? I began to study, and some of you heard me say this, but the word revival, it means, when you study it out, it means to revive. That's what it means. So me, whenever I read it, it means revive. Well then, what does revive mean? And here's what it means. It means to bring back to the consciousness and use of life. You know what he's saying? He's saying this, Lord, would you bring me back to the use of life again? You know, everybody has been revived if you're saved at least one time in your life. That was the day you got saved. God brought you to the consciousness of life. But you know what happens to us over time? We forget what God has done for us. That's the reason 2 Peter chapter 1 is in our Bible. He said that we add unto our faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness charity. And he goes on to say, if these things be in you and abound in you, they make you that you shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the things of God. And he goes on to say, he says, wherefore I think it meet, as long as I'm in this tabernacle, to stir you up by putting you what? In remembrance. Why did they need to be stirred up by way of remembrance? Because they had forgot what the Lord had done for them. They had forgot the blessings of God. They had forgot how good God really was. Hear me and hear me well. The first step to backsliding is an attitude of forgetfulness in what God has done for us and the blessings of God on our life. Let me tell you another step back. I've been studying backsliding. I was going to preach on it today and God wouldn't let me. Let me tell you another step for it. Unthankfulness. You ever talk to somebody and always complain about what they don't have? You ever talk to somebody and it's just always complaints? It's never nothing positive. It's never God's really been good to me. But it's always something. Somebody holler, amen. It's always something wrong. That's a step in backsliding tonight. And that's the reason he says, I want to put you in remembrance. The Bible said, Lord, would you revive us again? Let me tell you what we need at Amazing Grace. We need revival. We need revival. That's what we need God to stir our hearts again. We need God to remind us one more time what He's done for us. Well, I give you verses on the first two questions. Here's the answer to the last question. Lord, will Thou not revive us again? Here it is. If my people. Who is that? That's the saved. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and heal their land. Here it is tonight. We pray and ask God for forgiveness, but we don't humble ourselves and turn from our wicked ways. Therefore, God is not hearing our prayer and God is not forgiving our sins. And that's the reason we're in a need of revival.
Amen.
He says, yes, I'll do it. Let me show you three things. And I've showed you these before, but let me show it to you again tonight. If we're ever going to see revival, number one, we must get hungry for God. We must get hungry for God. You may say, well, preacher, I am hungry for God. Well, can I ask you a question? I want you to answer it out loud. I want to ask you a question, and I want you to answer it in your mind. How much did you pray for this service tonight? Then are you really hungry for God? I want to ask you this question tonight. How many walked in the church tonight expecting to get the blow slam out of the banks, the choir to get up and sing, and the Shekinah glory of God fall and us shout it out for 2 hours? Then are we really hungry for God? If we're ever going to see a move, I know we're quiet tonight, but that's all right. If we're ever going to see another move of God, we're going to have to get hungry for it. We're going to have to get hungry. Listen to what your Bible said in Matthew 6 or Matthew 5. He said, blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness. Now listen to this. For they shall be filled. They shall be filled. You get hungry for God and you get thirsty for God and a move of God. And you know what He said He'd do? He would fill us. That's what He said. That's not debatable. That's a direct promise from God. But every promise from God hinges on man's choices. If my people, that's a choice, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves, pray, seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways. Then, there's the consequence. Will I hear from heaven and forgive their sins and heal their land? Here it is. Blessed are they that do hunger and thirst after righteousness. That's the choice that man's got to make. Here's the consequence. For they shall be filled. Maybe the reason you're not experiencing revival in your life is because there's no hunger for God. There's no hunger for the Word of God. There's no hunger for prayer. There's no hunger for the will of God in your life. Where's our hunger at tonight? Where's our hunger at tonight? Can I tell you something? I can listen to you talk 15 minutes and tell you where your hunger's at. Amen. Out of the abundance of the heart, what? The mouth speaketh. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. It's all right to sit around and carry on a conversation about hunting. Hunting season's coming up. I said this morning, I ain't hunted in years, but for some reason, I just got a hankering the other day to start hunting again, Brother Robert. So I decided I was going to hunt a little bit again this year. And in a couple of weeks, matter of fact, the week of Thanksgiving, I'm going to go shoot some ducks and mount them and put them in my office. Amen. And I was talking to Brother Tim. Y'all pray for Brother Tim, man. He's really going through a hard time right now. But he's a taxidermist. I was talking to Brother Tim today. I said, are you going to mount him? He said, no, I don't mount no ducks. And I said, all right. I said, well, the 1st of December, I said, I'm going bear hunting for 2 or 3 days. And I said, I'll get you to mount the bear. And I said, we'll mount the bear standing up in my office, Brother Robert, and the ducks coming up off of a pond. And I said, that bear reaching out trying to get them ducks. He said, you going to deer hunt too? I said, yeah. And I said, we'll do a full mount on him with his head down, going in towards the bear, fixing to get it. I said, we'll even put us a pond. I said, time out, Brother Tim. I said, I'm going to call business meeting tonight and go ahead and add on to my office, go into another building program so he can hang everything in there. It's all right to talk about that stuff. It's all right to talk about that. It's all right to talk about a ball game. But if that's all you ever talk about, then friend, something's wrong. Something's wrong. There's a hunger for God Psalms 4 said this, as the hart panteth after the water brooks, so panteth my soul after thee. Oh God, my soul thirsteth for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? Psalm 63 said, oh God, thou art my God, early will I seek thee. My soul thirsteth for thee, my flesh longeth for thee, in a dry and thirsty land where no water is, to see thy power and thy glory, so as I have seen thee in the sanctuary. You know what David is saying? He said, man, I remember those days when I saw God and I saw the move of God and the sanctuary of God, and my soul longeth for that again. What about this? Psalms 84. He said, my soul longeth, yea, even fainteth for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh crieth out for the living God. You know what he's saying? He said, I'm hungry for God. I thought about this. We should be as hungry for God and as desperate for the move of God as we are our next breath. As we are our next breath. Can I just say this to you tonight, and I'm going to move on. When you get that hungry for God, then you'll start seeing your family get saved. When we get that hungry for God, Brother Dakota, then we'll start seeing revival fires begin to burn. He said, I hunger for thee. David said, I want thee. More than life itself, we should have a hunger for God tonight. Can I ask you something? Are you hungry? Are you hungry? Are you hungry? I in fasting, and I'm not going to go into no great depths of how much I fasted or anything like that, but in fasting, that first day or so, those hunger pains set in. Are you with me? But after that, and you know what's happening? Your body's adjusting to that, and those hunger pains go away. Why? Because you've been without it. Let me tell you what I'm afraid we're getting to in our churches today. We've been without the breath of God so long, and we've been without the move of God so long, that we don't even know that we're hungry anymore and need it. Let me tell you something. I'm just going to be real with you. If I go through a week and God don't meet with me in an unusual way, man, I'm worried, I'm upset, I'm wondering, God, where are you at? What have I done wrong, man? They should be a hunger. They should be a hunger for the things of God. Number two tonight, not only we must get hungry before God, but I would say this, we must get honest with God. If we're going to see revival, we've got to get honest with God. I think sometimes we think that we can fool God. You hear me right there? But Joe, I really think sometimes we think that we can fool God. Because we're in church tonight, God thinks we're all right. Now, if they sin in your life, God already knows that, and God knows you're not all right. Are you with me? Every once in a while, hardly ever, but every once in a while, I'll catch one of my girls in a lie. And I say something like this, Brother Stan, if you just be honest with me, things will be a whole lot easier. And usually, I'm long-suffering with them, Miss Gay. If you'll just be honest, I'm going to give you another, just be honest with me. Things will be a whole lot easier if you'll just be honest with me. Well, I'm done. Go to your room and wait on me. You with me tonight? I wonder every once in a while if God don't go, if you just be honest with me, things will be a whole lot better. If you just be honest with me tonight, I was preaching and this past Wednesday night, I was preaching in meeting, and as I was preaching on knowing who our enemy is and recognizing our enemy, and I was preaching on Satan and how Satan was the enemy of the church, and Satan was the enemy of the home, and he is our adversary that's walking about as a roaring lion. And I said this, I said, the people sitting in this room is not your enemy, and I just kept going, man. I give the altar call, the altar literally filled up. Matter of fact, everybody in the church was in the altar. Everybody, 100%, was in the altar. Madeline was the only one not in the altar, but it's because she's on the piano playing. Everybody else was in the altar. And after service, I watched one go to another one and get them and come back to the altar and make things right with them. See, in your mind, you may be telling yourself that everything's all right, but God already knows. And if we would just get honest with God and just be honest with ourselves and realize that we're backslidden and we're out of God's will because we've left our first love, and because there was a time that we read our Bible more and we prayed more, and there was a time that we was more hungry for God. Can I tell you something? If you'd just be honest, things sure would go a whole lot better.
Yes, sir.
If we'd just be honest, the problem is this. We have a problem. We have a problem with being honest. We have a problem with being honest before the Lord. When in all reality, He already knows. He already knows. Are you hearing me tonight, church? He already knows. God knows if you've got that little seed of bitterness already in your life. God knows if you've got that little seed of malice already in your life. God knows if you've got a problem with somebody in the church or with me. God knows that already. And it would be really beneficial to you and to the church to be honest before God and lay that down before God. And if you need to, lay it down before that individual. Amen. And get honest with God. If we ever see revival, if we ever see revival, we're going to have to get honest. If we ever see revival, we're going to have to get hungry. Let me give you one more and we'll go home. Number three tonight, if we're going to see revival, we're going to have to be honest. We're going to have to be hungry. But watch this, we're going to have to be humble. What did he say? I've already quoted the verse, 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people, which are called by my name, shall what? Humble themselves. That's the very first stipulation. Humble ourselves. Pride is killing our country today. Pride is killing our country today. You know what we do when we pray? We get down on our knees a lot of times when we pray. Why? Because we're saying, God, I'm humbling myself before you. Let me say something. Because an individual has a backbone and stands for what's right and stands firm on the Word of God when it comes to the doctrines of the Word of God does not mean they're prideful and arrogant.
Amen.
You with me right there? It doesn't mean they're prideful and arrogant. When a preacher opens the Bible and preaches sound doctrine and preaches it firm, it does not mean he's arrogant. It means that he has humbled himself before God and God has transformed him into somebody else to thunder out the Word of God. Don't misplace boldness with pride and arrogance. We're going to have to get humble before God. Let me tell you the reason you won't get honest before God and hungry with God. Because to do that, you're going to have to get humble before God. And to get humble before God, it may cause you to get humble to your brother or your sister in Christ. It may cause you to humble yourself to them. Well, bless God, I tell you right now, I ain't going to them. They can come to me if they want to say something. Boy, that's real humble, isn't it? That's real humble, isn't it? That's just, boy, you're really doing God a favor, aren't we? Humbling ourselves before the Lord. Humbling ourselves before the Lord. If we'll humble ourselves, then we'll find ourselves being honest. And we'll find ourselves with a hunger for God. I read this week. God's problem today is not communism, nor yet Romanism, nor liberalism, nor modernism. God's problem today is dead fundamentalism. Let me tell you the reason there's dead fundamentalism today. because we're just used to going to church and a couple songs being sung by the choir and a special song being sung, a preacher preaching 30 to 45, 50 minutes, giving an altar call and going home. And it's become nothing more than a routine. And we have absolutely lost our hunger for God. Our hunger for God. I think back to 2016. In 2016, we had a revival, the beginning of 2016 here at the church that broke out. Went 2 weeks, and that was the revival Brother Craig got saved in. But then also in 2016, we had that great Foothills revival that went 5 weeks. Over 200 was saved in it. 9 preachers called out of it. And after the first week going into the second week, you'll remember the Friday night of the first week, we was not even scheduled to have service on that Friday night. But we had church anyway, and we just to see what God wanted to do. And we got there on that Friday night, and Northwood was literally packed out on that Friday night. Over 750 people, it was packed out. A service that was called in less than 24 hours that we was going to have it. You remember we came back on Monday night, and when we came back on Monday night, it was packed out again. Tuesday night, it was packed out again. Wednesday, we had the pastor's meeting and looked at buying the tent. Wednesday night, we told everybody that we had bought a tent, and on Thursday, they was going to get it, and they went and picked it up on Thursday. And then on Friday, we showed it to everybody. And then Saturday, we began setting, as Daddy called it, Big Blue up. We began setting the tent up. And you remember going into that third week of that meeting, the tent was going up. We was trying to find sound system. We was trying to find chairs. We was trying to build platforms. Man, it was just all the spare of the moment. And people would come in, Brother Robert, saying this. They would get there an hour, hour and a half early. They'd walk underneath the tent, man, and sweat would be running off us. We was trying to get things set up, trying to figure out how to have a tent meeting. We ain't never had a tent meeting. And literally overnight, we went from never having a tent meeting to owning a 1,500-seat tent, trying to figure out how in the world to have a tent meeting. But you know, when God's in it, it'll all work out. And we saw that. People would get there an hour and a half, 2 hours early, and they would come sit down in the tent. And I'd walk by them and say, hey, how y'all? Man, I'd still have my work clothes on. And here's what they'd say. We just got here as quick as we could today because we just can't wait to see what God's going to do tonight. We just can't wait to see what God's going to do tonight. I remember we would start grabbing sound equipment out, and Heath would come sliding in, and he'd run up there and start grabbing stuff for Brother Charlie and Brother Matt, and Heath would say something like this, man, all day long, I just couldn't wait to get back down here. I just couldn't wait to see what, I know something big's going to happen tonight. I couldn't wait to get back and see what God was going to do. And for the next 3 weeks, it was like that. You remember that anticipation in your soul. When you pulled up on the grounds, saw that great big tent, them big banners hanging up, Foothills Revival. And you heard that 200 voice youth choir stand up and thunder out. That anticipation that was in your soul. Let me tell you the reason it was there. Because somewhere in the first week or two, you got humble before God and you got honest with God, and then you had a hunger for God. That's the reason you was there. You was anticipating seeing God do something. And boy, did we ever see God do something in those days. Hear me and hear me well. We should come into church Wednesday night with that same anticipation. We should come into church next Sunday morning with that same anticipation. Man, I just can't wait to get there. I can't wait to hear that choir sing. I can't wait to see who's going to sing a special song. I can't wait for Brother Jamie to get up and thunder out the Word of God. Hear me and hear me well. He'll preach himself to death next Sunday. If we would just come in church humbled before God and honest with God and hungry for a move of God. Yes, sir. One more time. People canceled vacations to be at that meeting. Canceled family trips that they'd been going on every year the same week to be at that meeting. You want me to tell you the reason why? They was hungry. They was hungry. I say this to you tonight. He said, For I am the Lord thy God, and I change not. If there was a time you had more anticipation of going to the house of God than you did tonight coming here, it's not God's fault that you didn't have that same anticipation tonight. I don't have to have a great big choir singing every night and people running up and down the aisles of a tent every night and a preacher preaching every night to keep me on fire for God. My daily walk with God should be enough. The reason you got so hungry for it is because you was having a daily diet of the Word of God. But that should continue in your personal life. Amen. On a daily basis. I ask you this question tonight. Do you want revival? I'm not saying that the meeting next week goes for 5 weeks. Thank God if it does. If that's what He orders, then that's what we'll do. But I am saying this. The same God can be right here next week and do the same work in our hearts and lives that He did that 5 weeks in 6 days. If we just get honest with God. He already knows. He already knows that you're cold. He already knows that you're indifferent. He already knows that you're not reading your Bible like you once did. He already knows that you're not praying like you once did. Why don't you just come to an altar tonight and get honest with Him and ask Him to forgive you for it? And then say, God, give me that hunger one more time. God, give me that. I'm going to tell you. I told Brother Whitthrow. I told Brother, I live for that, Brother Dakota. Me and Brother David was talking. Please continue to pray for Brother David Edwards. He's still really sick. He was able to go to church this morning, but he just read a few verses. He really needs our prayers. He's still real sick. Brother David, we was talking the other day. I was up there preaching a meeting. We rode out to the hunting club and was looking around. And he said, preacher, he said, I long for those times that we're back underneath the glory while we're preaching. I live for it, Dakota. You know what I'm saying. How hungry are we for God? Father, as we stand with our heads bowed and our eyes closed tonight,